Show some dignity.
I'm asleep, 'cause everything is never as it seems. 'Cause I get 1,000 hugs from 10,000 lightning bugs as they tried to teach me how to dance. A foxtrot above my head, a sock hop beneath my bed. A disco ball is just hanging by a thread.
Tell you who to blame. Blame the boy lying at your feet, his body oozing life through the hole in his stomach where the bullet tore him apart. Blame him for challenging you, for not looking away and for not backing down when you pulled out the gun. Blame your mother for bringing you into this world when she was but a kid herself and for dragging you up, not bringing you up. Blame society for not giving you hope. Blame your father for not being there. The man who looked after himself instead of looking after you. Blame the gun in your hand for making you a target, for making you more likely to be picked on. Blame the dead boy, blame your mother, blame society, blame your father, blame the gun, blame anyone but yourself for not being strong enough to put down the gun, to break the cycle.
Against the world, Ray Charles. Y'all just halfway thoughts, not worth the back of my mind. But to understand the future, we have to go back in time.
Separate raw meats from other foods by using different cutting boards. 3,000 Americans will die from food poisoning this year. Keep your family safer. Check your steps at foodsafety.gov.
Two outs with a runner on first base. Now the big guy comes up to bat, hitting 342 with 92 RBIs and 36 home runs.
Chill raw and prepared foods promptly. 1 in 6 Americans will get sick from food poisoning this year. Keep your family safer. Check your steps at foodsafety.gov. Foods to the right temperature using a food thermometer. 3,000 Americans will die from food poisoning this year. Keep your family safer. Check your steps at foodsafety.gov. Kitchen surfaces, utensils, and hands with soapy water. 1 in 6 Americans will get sick from food poisoning this year. Keep your family safer. Check your steps at foodsafety.gov.
Everybody needs a change, a chance to check out the news.
Oh! How mad do you get when you see something wrong taking place? Just take another look at what happens when our innocent bystanders reach the boiling point.
Deep in the heart of Texas, at this little roadside bakery, bigotry is being served with a coffee and Danish.
Sir, I had a question.
No, ma'am. We don't serve Muslims here.
I'm sorry?
This is America. We're at war with your people.
I don't know what you think I am. I'm just trying to get an apple.
Well, you're a terrorist is what you are. So,
excuse me?
You gotta take your business elsewhere. We don't serve your kind here.
The other customers at this bakery near Waco seem to hear everything, but they barely look at the Muslim woman, even when the language is tough to take.
Get back on the camel and go back wherever you came from.
Sir, I'm an American. I was born and raised in this
country. No, you're not. Americans don't wear towels on their head.
Muslim Americans say these are words they hear all the time in all parts of the country. But here at the bakery, what the customers don't know is that this Muslim woman and the man behind the counter are actors. The bakery is working with us, all part of a primetime hidden camera experiment on prejudice and patriotism.
Please take your business elsewhere. Am I asking too much?
When no one even tries to help her, she makes a direct appeal.
Sir, would you mind ordering me an apple strudel? That's why I'm here. I can give you the money. I have no problem.
That's not a problem with the money, huh?
Please no, sir.
Huh?
I'm not going to let you work.
But when he gives her the cold shoulder, she finally just leaves.
You could have helped her out. You could have spoken up. Why not?
Me speak up for her? Well, if he tried to do some harm to her or something, then I would have.
But why not try to set him straight?
I really think that a person that owns his own business should be able to say who they sell to.
She's not American.
Others seem to agree with our actor as to who's an American and who's not. Is it all based on the way we look?
I'm an American citizen. I just would like an apple strudel, please.
Well, I'm sorry. Then why don't you dress like an American? You're
so
American.
This is for religious purposes, sir, and I don't think you have any right to say anything.
So I'm religious. I don't wear, you know, Halloween costumes around. I mean, am I wrong here, sir?
Not me.
I run my business the way I want to run.
Right. Don't come in here with that shirt on.
This customer is adamant that the man behind the counter is doing the right thing.
I'm ready for you.
But the fact is, it's against the law to deny service to someone based on their race or religion.
My name is John Quinones, and I'm with ABC News. What did you think of what you heard here?
I didn't hear anything racist.
He told her he wouldn't serve her.
Well, he can say he wouldn't serve you if you come in here barefooted without a shirt on.
But she wasn't barefoot or without a shirt on.
Well, she wasn't dressed right.
What do you mean?
If I was running a place, I'd do the same thing.
You wouldn't let Muslims shop at your store?
I sure wouldn't.
We never expected customers to be so candid.
How do I know you don't have a bomb in there?
Watch what happens this time when, once again, our Muslim woman is denied service.
This is not right.
And again leaves.
I mean, we reserve the right to not serve.
That's right.
A certain kind.
That's right. That's, I appreciate seeing that. I think that's the first time I've ever seen that.
He not only commends the man behind the counter for his discriminatory behavior, but he gives them the thumbs up, not once, but twice.
Good job.
All right.
As he leaves.
So can I talk to you, sir, for a second?
But when I approach...
Sir, where with ABC News?
There is no thumbs up for me.
We staged a little experiment in there to see how people would react to that kind of attitude.
You're not an American.
I am an American.
That man took it a bit farther, telling me I'm not an American.
He was threatened.
Jack DeVideo is a social psychologist at Yale University.
So when we as Americans feel threatened from the outside, we're going to define ourselves in very rigid fashions. Either you're with me, and if you're not really one of me, then you must be somebody else who's against me.
The young woman in our experiment is an actor. But for this woman, discrimination is all too real. Nahaya Javed helped us design our experiment. Although born in Chicago, she says she's constantly characterized by fellow Americans as the enemy.
They always start off with, you're a terrorist, a Osama lover, towel head, camel jockey, on and on.
While attending college in Texas, she says she continually suffered verbal abuse and has even been physically attacked just because she's Muslim.
They assume I'm not from here, and if I tell them I'm American, they're like, no, you're not. Just because you were born here doesn't make you American. And I'm like, so what makes you American?
It's a daily battle.
Mm-hmm. and I don't feel like living in America, I should have to fight this battle.
Meanwhile, back at the bakery, our actor is at it again.
But how do I know you're not a terrorist? Terrorists look like you.
But this time, the customers are sympathizing with the Muslim woman.
You got a question. Come on, leave me alone.
Right, I know, but can you blame me?
Yeah, I can't blame you, actually.
Why? What's the problem?
All right, we'll get out of here.
Dressed like an American.
Big deal.
She's Muslim.
And unlike the others, they don't just leave in anger. They stand their ground.
So you're going to regulate what people wear?
Yes, because I believe
the
degree
manager?
Of... No, I'm not the manager.
Well, can I speak to your manager?
Please. I'm John Quinones with ABC News.
It's only when we catch up with our heroines that they finally let their guards down.
I'm with my friend who's, you know, Muslim, and that's, you know, I've just seen how people treat them differently. And it really hurts me.
Just watching them stand up for what they believe in touches Professor Davidio.
In a way, they defended America. And I was impressed by that because they wanted this to be a just society, a just place, a just bakery.
I'm John Quinones.
And remember this man whose son served in Iraq? He's also moved to tears.
Every person deserves to be treated with respect and dignity.
No matter how they're dressed.
In every situation, no matter how they're dressed.
At the end of the day, 13 people stood up for the Muslim woman, while 6 sided with the clerk. But the majority of the bystanders, 22, did or said absolutely nothing. That's what's most frightening to Muslims like Nahaya, who was watching our experiment. In fact, so frightening that they often avoid going out by themselves.
It's really sad because I'm old enough to be able to do things by myself. I shouldn't need a chaperone all the time. But that one time that I'm alone and something bad might happen, I'd rather be safe than sorry.
Hi, I'm Nahaya.
It's no wonder this young woman was so moved by the people who came forward to protect a stranger who just happens to be Muslim.
Thank you so much for what you did, and I wish more people would do these type of things. And
I do too.
It would make my life a lot easier.
God go with you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
כל מה שקורה לנו. מה שלא מספרים לאף אחד, אפילו לא לבעלים ולא לילדים,
אנחנו בעינינו תמיד. זה לא יחיד, זה שנינו ביחד.
אני זוכרת שהוציא אותנו מהקרונות מלא אססים עם כלבים, המון המון אנשים, בלגן גדול וצעקות שמישהו צועק שם צווילינגן, צווילינגן, שזה בגרמנית תאומים. אז אמא שלי שאלה מה זה טוב להגיד צווילינגן, אז הוא אומר מה יכול להיות, תגידי.
ואחר כך לקחו אותנו
לבלוק הזה של תאומים, שהיו שם הרבה תאומים, בכלל לא ידענו שיש כל כך הרבה תאומים.
אנחנו שמה ואנחנו מוכנות תמיד, מתי שקוראים לנו,
ללכת לנישואים. אנחנו, זה בעצם מה שהתפקיד, זה התפקיד של התאומים. עשו כל מיני נישואים, וזה כאב. ואז אנחנו צרחנו. הם לא הסכימו, הם רצו שאנחנו נהיה שקטים ושנעשה מה שהם רוצים.
אלה שהיו חלשות ולא היו נראות טוב, הם לקחו אותם.
לא חזרו, לא חזרו. עד כדי כך שאמא אמרה לנו, שלפני שלוקחים אותנו לנישואים, למנגל, נצפות את הפנים שלנו, שאנחנו נהיה אדומות ושנראה טוב. אתה אף פעם לא ידעת מה שיעשו לך שם, ואף פעם לא ידעת אם תחזור משם.
יש שם שתי ילדות עם כובעים על הראש. זה התמונה שלנו. הדברים הטובים שקרו, שנולדו לנו ילדים.
בגלל שאמרו שהנישואים האלו גורמים,
הרבה נשים לא יכלו להביא ילדים לעולם. האבא שלי, שאני התחתנתי, אז הוא סיפר לבעל שלי שאני הייתי בשואה ועשו נישואים, שהוא ייקח את זה בחשבון, שאי אפשר לדעת התוצאות.
והרגע הכי מאושר, לא שנולדו, נולדו תאומים. אז אתה יכול לתאר לעצמך איזה אושר.
My name is Kyle, and I'm here to talk about A Midsummer Night's Dream, one of Shakespeare's most well-known and well-received comedies. It's a tale of love, magic, and wacky misunderstandings.
And a bit of bestiality.
This play has a lot going on, which, coupled with Shakespeare's heightened language, can be overwhelming. My goal is to simplify things for you. So, let's get started. Now, Midsummer has oodles of characters, but for brevity's sake, here are the only ones you really need to care about. First are the four young Athenian lovers, all full of hormones and feelings and poor life choices. There's the handsome Lysander, the suave Demetrius, the beautiful Hermia, and Helena. Hermia and Lysander are madly in love, but Hermia's father isn't on board, as he's already arranged for her to marry Demetrius, who, of course, is also wildly in love with her. Helena, meanwhile, is obsessively in love with Demetrius, but sadly, nobody loves Helena. Next, we have the fairies living in a forest outside of Athens. There's the fairy queen, Titania, with her many loyal servants, and the fairy king, Oberon, with his one obnoxious sidekick, Puck. The fairy king and queen once ruled together, but have recently split up after what is essentially a custody dispute over a small human child. And finally, we have the Mechanicals, a group of blue-collar workers who have formed a small theater troupe set to perform a play at the wedding of the future Duke and Duchess of Athens. For our purposes, the only one worth mentioning is Nick Bottom, a weaver and a pompous dunce who plays the lead role in the troupe's production. But we'll get to him later. Are you ready for this? Because I'm not sure I am. Hermia disregards her father's wishes and runs off to elope with Lysander. Demetrius, having lost his would-be wife, chases after them, and Helena, being her desperate self, comes along for the ride, and before long, the four naive lovers find themselves lost in the woods. Meanwhile, Oberon, seeking petty revenge, instructs Puck to enchant Titania with a love potion that will make her fall head over heels for the first thing she lays eyes on. Then, feeling pity after witnessing Helena's failed attempts at courtship, he orders Puck to enchant Demetrius as well. Here's where the fun starts. First, Puck goes to pour some love juice on Demetrius, but whoops! Since he doesn't actually know what Demetrius looks like, he accidentally enchants Lysander instead, who forgets Hermia exists and becomes instantly smitten with Helena. Then, attempting to fix Puck's mistake, Oberon enchants Demetrius as well, meaning that both men have now fallen in love with the once loveless Helena. Unfortunately, this leads to an insulted Helena, believing that the men have joined forces to mock her, a furious and love-stricken Lysander and Demetrius ready to fight to the death for Helena's hand, and a jealous and heartbroken Hermia prepared to gouge Helena's eyes out! So yeah. Things didn't really go according to plan. On the other hand, phase two of Oberon's scheme goes off without a hitch when Titania wakes up and becomes infatuated with Bottom the Weaver, who, by the way, now has the head of a donkey thanks to Puck. So that happens. Anyway, hijinks are had, laughs are shared, and Oberon runs off with the child. Mission accomplished! Still, there is the problem of the Athenian lovers all trying to murder each other. First, there's Lysander and Demetrius, which Puck solves by disguising his voice and drawing the two men as far away from each other as possible. Then there's Helena and Hermia, which Helena solves by being a coward and running away. Satisfied with the results of his scheme and tired of dealing with the Athenians, Oberon puts everyone to sleep, restores Bottom to his normal form, and ensures that the Athenian lovers are all with their proper mates. The play concludes with the wedding of the two couples, along with the Duke and Duchess, followed by a hilarious farcical play within a play performed by the Mechanicals, and topped off with a wonderful speech delivered to the audience by Puck. And that about covers it. Hopefully, when you go to read the play, and you will read it, you'll be able to use this video to help keep track of what's what. Thanks for watching, and let me know what other plays you'd like to see abridged.
You once again. into the jungle. There ain't no God on my streets, in the heart of the jungle. Won't you follow me into the jungle?
As I said before, we've found out an awful lot about God and the sense of humor. The mother's curse works. My wife and I have 5 children, and the reason why we have 5 children is because we do not want 6. And those we have, we want to get out of the house before we die. Just to get them out. My wife was a beautiful woman before the children came. I've never met a more beautiful looking woman in the face, in the body, and in the mind than my wife. Then the children came, and that curse began to take its toll. My wife's face began to change. The corners of her mouth dropped down. And when she talked, her eyebrows went up and down. And her right hand became deformed. And when she talked, she shook her finger like this one. I tell you, little, you get over here, I don't you tell me. It's what the curse did to her. But the reason why the curse works is because all children have brain damage. And that's what makes the parents' face look like that. Now, those of you who have no children, let me describe the brain damage. You come in the room with a Coca-Cola. You set it down, you go to get a newspaper. Child comes walking in, grabs the drink, starts to, you say, give me that. Didn't I just tell you not to drink it? The child says, aha. You say, what did I just say? You said, for two knock, for two drinks, you drink. Every time I tell you that, don't I? I say, when I have a drink, don't you drink it. Don't I say that? Uh-huh. Now tell me what I said. You said, what to not, what to drink, to drink. That's right. You put it down. You go to get the paper. The child picks it up again. And quickly starts to drink it. You say, give me that. Didn't I just tell you? Uh-huh. Well, why did you do it? I don't know. Well, that's brain damage. If you know you're not supposed to do something, and you do it, and then people say, why did you do it? You say, I don't know. Brain damage. And that's what parents have to deal with all day. That's all you see. People, I don't know, I don't know, I don't know. You get 2 people in the house, and they start to yell, will you stop touching me? Will you stop touching me? And you have to get up and go find out what's going on. So you run over, you say, what's going on? Well, she's touching me. So you figure you can solve it. Look, don't touch her anymore, okay? Yeah, but she touched me first. And you say, well, why didn't you tell her? Now you're talking like that. Why didn't you say you had touched her first? Well, I didn't touch her. Somebody touched her. So you say something brilliant. Like, look, I don't want anybody in this house to touch another person as long as you live. And that's why people look the way they look. My parents never smiled because I had brain damage. My wife and I don't smile because our children are loaded with it. Oh, my parents smile now whenever they come over to my house. and they see how much trouble I'm having, oh, they have a ball. Have a little trouble, huh, son?
Up in the morning, bump this in your stereo. In your car or blaze it in your disco. People look confused, what is this, yo? Hip-hop, a little bit of reggae in it. This one is for those who like the old school. Try to hate on us, the new school fool. Let's take it back to basics, use the old tools. Check this out now, let me tell you how to do it. Let your body work, can you feel it jerk? This one's gonna make you move till your body hurts. Until the morning lights, right, right, right. Let your body work, yeah. Can you feel it jerk? Yeah. This one's gonna make you move till your body hurts, yeah. We're gonna dance until the morning lights, right, 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 right.
Shake, rattle and roll and keep it jiggy, jiggy. All my girls dip low and keep it flicky, flicky. Now let it loose, let's let it go and act silly. Mr. DJ,
can you turn it up a little?
Off the wall and stop your posing. Scoofy is just standing looking frozen. Hurry, bust a move, the club is closing. Hit the dance floor, let me tell you how to do it.
Let your body work, yeah. Can you feel it jerk?
Yeah.
This one's gonna make you move till your body hurts,
yeah.
We're gonna dance until the morning lights, right, right, right. Let your body work,
yeah.
Can you feel it jerk?
Yeah.
This one's gonna make you move till your body hurts,
yeah.
Until the morning lights, right, right, right.
Hey, break it down.
This one is making you silly, it makes you jump around.
Hey, break it down.
Only better get on your feet, I don't want you sitting down.
Hey, break it down.
Let's start the whining, start the grinding, let's just gather around.
Hey, break it down.
Cause good music always come back around. Ask your grandmother and grandfather about this, how they were twisting and shaking when they first heard this. 40 years later, now it's back on the playlist. We recycled it and now they're back in business.
We put it back in the pot and yes, we're stirring it up. We add some sugar and the spice and now we're making it hot. And now we're running your city and yes, we're running your block. And when we come, you know we're never gonna stop to just.
Let your body work,
yeah.
Can you feel it jerk?
Yeah.
This one's gonna make you move till your body hurts,
yeah.
We're gonna dance until the morning lights, right.
Let your body work,
yeah.
Can you feel it jerk?
Yeah.
This one's gonna make you move till your body hurts,
yeah. We're gonna dance until the morning lights,
my wife woke me up 4 o'clock in the morning. She said, I want you to go downstairs and cook breakfast for the children. And I looked at the clock. I said, dear, it's 6 o'clock in the morning. She said, exactly. Go down and cook for the children. They have to go to school. I said, yes, but to eat at 6 o'clock, isn't that bad for your stomach? I mean, they just ate 12 hours ago. My wife said, Bill, get out of that bed and go downstairs and cook breakfast for your children. And I said, well, I don't know what they want to eat. She said, it's down there. Now you'll get out of the bed. I said, but where are the pans? Do we have pans to cook with? She said, Bill, I'm not talking to you anymore. You ask another stupid question, so help me God, I'll get the shotgun out of the closet and blow your face off. So I said, well, there's no need to become violent about this. Seem to be having trouble intellectualizing on where the cooking apparel is. So I fell back to sleep again. The next thing I knew, there was a bucket of ice water being shaken over my head. And this woman I've been married to for some 17 years was standing over me like this. Now you get up and cook some breakfast, or you're gonna wear this bucket of ice water. So I said, you're serious, aren't you? So I got up. Needless to say, I was angry. And I went downstairs without putting on my robe. Standing there in my pajamas, and I'm talking to myself, I got to get these, went out and cooked breakfast, but it was 6 o'clock in the morning, and I slammed the pans down. Blah! On the stove, and slam them down, and go to the refrigerator, and look around and get the damn bacon and the sausage. Cooking breakfast, 6 o'clock, blam! In the morning, and I grabbed it. You have to be careful with eggs. Cut! You cook breakfast, and blew! Turn around. The first one down was a 4-year-old. The child looked lovely. Cute little face, clean hair, little braids, little things, you know.
Come on, darling.
And I said, what do you want for breakfast? The 4-year-old has the ability to see through and find the wrong thing. And the child saw through my body what was behind me. She saw the chocolate cake.
And she said, can I have the chocolate cake?
And I said, chocolate cake where?
She said, chocolate cake behind you.
And I looked, and there was chocolate cake. The child wanted chocolate cake for breakfast. How ridiculous. And I said, and someone in my brain looked under chocolate cake and saw the ingredients. Eggs. Eggs are in chocolate cake. And milk. Oh, goody. And wheat. That's nutrition. What do you want?
That's a chocolate cake.
Chocolate cake coming up. Sliced it for her and served it. Now, you need something to drink with the chocolate cake, something breakfast. Grapefruit juice. This is not your child. So I give the child a glass of grapefruit juice, and chocolate cake, nutrition, eggs, milk, and wheat in the chocolate cake. And I didn't have to cook. And the other four came downstairs. When they came downstairs, those of you who have children, you've seen them come downstairs for school. And they got to the kitchen. And they saw the four-year-old eating chocolate cake. And they said, Dad, where did she get the chocolate cake? And they went to the child and said, how did you get chocolate cake? He said, Dad, give me chocolate cake. And they looked at me and they said, Father. Could we have chocolate cake? And their father said, chocolate cake, coming up. Four slices. And grapefruit juice. And five children sat at breakfast. And the morning music was playing. And they were eating chocolate cake. And singing songs to me. Dad is great. Give us a chocolate cake. And we had a ball. Until... She came down like this. And when she saw what the children were eating, I've always heard about people having a conniption, but I've never seen one. You don't want to see them. My wife's face split. The skin and hair split and came off of her face so that there was nothing except a skull. An orange light came out of her hair and it lit all around. And fire shot from her eye sockets and began to burn my stomach. And she said, and I said, they asked for it. And the children who had been singing praises to me lied on me and said, we asked for eggs and milk, and Dad made us eat this. And my wife sent me to my room, which is where I wanted to go in the first place.